Okay, so let me start with the prologue. So it's based on a work with Misha Entov. So we are living in a jet space of a manifold X, considered as a contact manifold, so with the standard contact form dz minus pdq. And the rep vector field here is ddz, rep flow is rt, is kind of standard shift along the z coordinates. And in these coordinates, if we have a function h, we can consider it as a contact Hamiltonian function, right? So, of course, it depends on lambda, right? And for this choice of lambda, the formulas are like in Hamiltonian system, but with some kind of addition, so pdh dz for p dot, and z dot equals to h minus p dh dp. And we denote by ht the flow of this v. So very important feature of contact flows is that in contrast to Hamiltonian flows, and in contrast to rep vector field where Hamiltonian equals to one. So in principle, contact flows can dissipate. Okay, so the volume can dissipate and energy can dissipate. So in principle, you don't have conservation loss on the manifold. However, Legendrian submanifolds which lie in zero level set of a contact Hamiltonian are invariant. So that's the fact. And so phenomenon which we discussed with Entov is called interlinking. So we say that two disjoint Legendrian submanifolds lambda zero and lambda one and sigma are interlinked if there exists a constant with the following property. So for every bounded complete contact Hamiltonian, which is strictly positive, so bounded away by A from zero, there exists x and lambda zero and time interval between zero and mu over A, so that's how mu enters the play, with htx belongs to lambda one. So if your Hamiltonian is positive, so there exists a chord joining lambda zero to lambda one. And we say that interlinking is robust if every two nearby, let's say, Siban Legendrians are interlinked maybe with different value of mu. So now we say that a rep chord is non-degenerate if kind of obvious condition holds. So we take tangent space to the first submanifold, move it by differential with the flow, and look at the tangent space with the, another submanifold, and we want to generate the contact hyperplane at this point. So here is the theorem. So if X is closed, so let lambda zero be zero section and lambda one Legendrian isotopic to the zero section. So if for lambda zero, lambda one, there exists unique rep chord, which is non-degenerate, they are robustly interlinked. Okay, so if you have just one chord, it's non-degenerate and you have this unknotedness condition, which is important, yeah. So then the manifolds are interlinked. And technology uses Legendrian contact homology, Ляшберг, Чеканов, and many other people starting from their works. LCH persistence modules and barcodes, so after our work with Shilukin, so this persistence entered several areas in symplectic topology, and Dimitroglou, Rizel, and Sullivan, I think, were first who started to use it for Legendrian persistence. So then we with Misha and have continued, and we have kind of a secret manuscript, I don't know, 200 something pages, still unreleased, but there was a paper when we described what we used for this theorem. And another piece of an ingredient is Poisson bracket invariance. So somehow I believe that results of this kind maybe would be simpler when we will have kind of complete Legendrian contact homology theory, right? But I think it's still kind of under construction in general. So we have to use Poisson bracket invariants to detect one form, but we cannot detect several forms, several chords, for instance. Okay. So there are remarks in order. So first of all, it's wrong without the notedness assumption. So that's Dimitroglou result. It's recent result by Georgios. And Dimitroglou, Rizal, and Sullivan used some Legendrian version of Rabinowitz floor complex to detect interlinking. And final remark that Maxim Stokic used interlinking to get constraints on images of Legendrians under contact homeomorphism. So somehow this notion of interlinking, worth some exploration. We used this interlinking in order to get asymptotic trajectories of contact Hamiltonian flows. And in our setup, we have a Hamiltonian H so that Legendrian lambda 1 lives in the zero level, in the zero level of H. Okay? And so then let sigma be a connected component, some kind of nodal domain H bigger than zero. And we assume that dH of r is less than zero near m, and lambda 1 Legendrian, which is local attractor for the Hamiltonian flow. And the theorem is the following, that let lambda 0 and lambda 1 are robustly interlinked, so then under some mild extra assumptions on h, lambda 0 must intersect this nodal domain, sigma, and there exists a trajectory of the flow lying in sigma, which starts on lambda 0 and asymptotically converges to lambda 1. And this is kind of not a miracle, because what we use, so we perturb lambda 1 inside sigma, so then by interlinking we modify slightly Hamiltonian, by interlinking we get a chord, and so then we arrange the process with the dynamical conditions, which are here, so to build an asymptotic trajectory. Okay, so that's the approach. So prototypical example is just Hamiltonian minus CZ, right? And this Hamiltonian is simply gives a dynamics which completely contracts to the zero section. Okay, so now the message is that this technique provides you kind of possibility to see zero perturb your Hamiltonian, maybe outside of the Lagrangian, to still get chords. Okay. And another remark is that for Hamiltonian of the kind minus CZ plus F of PQ with convex F, so there was a work by Moreau and Sorrentino, which was extended by several people, including Wang Wang Yan. Yeah, and so where certain chords could be obtained by variational methods. Any questions at this point?
Yes. For your theorem on the previous slide, what's the class of contact manifolds, you think?
As formulated is in jet spaces. But in general, it's technology, so you can push it in many possible situations. We did not have an idea to prove the most general result. Yes?
Sorry, so in your first theorem, you assume that there is a unicorn.
Yes. Yes, I have at the end. Its example will be an epilogue. It is, we are still in prologue, but there are such examples. Yeah. Okay, I promise. Okay, so then let me continue. So that's, I should say that at this point, it's more or less end of mathematical part of the talk, okay? So the next part is ongoing work with several people, so Misha Antov, mathematical physicist Shinichiro Goto from Chubu University in Japan, my student Shai Lehrer and Leonie Ryzhik, professor at Stanford. And this is a work in progress. It's very much in progress, so don't expect kind of mathematical formulations. But I still, there is something I want to show you. Okay, so I wish to, first of all, to set the stage. So let's M-mil be manifold with a volume form. And I will tell you in the very beginning, so in a few slides, we will pass to one very specific example and deal most time with it. Still kind of I need some general setting. So this is the space of stage. So now we consider probabilities, the set of strictly positive probability densities. So with respect to muon M, we consider a Hamiltonian in some kind of, in another sense. It's not kind of, neither symplectic non-contact Hamiltonian, thermodynamical Hamiltonian. H, which depends on parameter Q, lying in Rn. Entropy is just minus integral over m rho ln rho d mu, okay? And free energy is a function phi Rn cross measures to R. Q rho goes to minus beta inverse entropy plus integral h rho d mu, okay? So h depends on the parameter, beta is inverse temperature. So that's kind of the setup. And what we want to do, we want to solve variational problem, phi of q rho for given q goes to extremum. So that's how thermodynamical equilibrium looks like. So solution is the Gibbs distribution, so rho equals to e in the power beta h divided by chi, where the latter is just integral, it's normalizing constant, so integral over m e minus beta h d mu. I will also introduce generalized pressure. So these are derivatives of phi over dqi and sine minus, so it's minus integral of m dh dqi rho d mu. So this is more or less kind of textbook material, okay? Now let's do the following thing. So consider thermodynamic phase space. It's just J1 Rn, so this is jet space to these parameter spaces. So these parameters play the major role. We consider jet spaces. And I wish to cite a very nice idea of Lim and O, Jungin O, who is here. They wrote a paper also on contact thermodynamics, and they maybe it's a kind of free interpretation of what they're doing, but what I learned from this paper is that one can use free energy as generating function of the equilibrium Legendre. So now it's a kind of textbook again material that there exists thermodynamic phase space, and then in the equilibrium, thermodynamic systems are described by Legendrian submanifolds, okay? And so in our language, it's nice to think about this Legendrian as something given by generating function phi, or actually minus phi, so d phi d rho equals to zero, p equals to minus d phi dq, and z equals minus phi, and so then as a result, you basically get the Gibbs distribution. So you can do its little calculation, you can get the Gibbs distribution. But I am interested in non-equilibrium thermodynamics. Yes?
Sorry, what's similar to an equilibrium Legendrian and an equilibrium distribution?
Pardon me?
You said you're equating somehow equilibrium Legendrians, which I don't know the definition of, with equilibrium distribution, the Gibbs.
Yeah, so for... For every Q, so I think you should look at this like this. So you have your Legendrian, right? So point on the Legendrian for given Q corresponds to a critical point of generating functions. But generating function is free energy. So what you're doing, you're kind of maximizing this free energy, and the corresponding rho, which is Ghost variable in usual sense, right? So corresponds to the Gibbs distribution. So that's the picture, okay? So now the an exciting part of the story is that if you start kind of playing such games in specific models, so then Legendrian, let's say, is given by something real analytic, and you see other parts of the Legendrian, which not exactly correspond to maximum of free energy. Okay, so then, okay, we will return to this. We will see some kind of some pieces of the Legendrian which are obtained by this procedure. Okay, and I think that, by the way, I mean this observation that certain pieces of Legendrian kind of out of picture, so they were known for physicists for ages, yeah, so it's called Maxwell phenomenon. And this, in this language, it's also mentioned in the paper by Lim and Yongyun, yeah. So, okay, but now I believe that with this story, so there are some maybe things to be clarified, you will see in which sense, right? But there is the major mysterious question. So I am interested in relaxation process. So relaxation process is a gradual return to the equilibrium after system is kicked out of the equilibrium. And there are no clear rules how to describe relaxation processes. Yeah, so I mean, there are several schools, and at least I cannot point to the model, okay, and so then the game is a little bit fuzzy because the rules of the game are understood in the process of the game, so to say, okay. So Prigozhin, so why there is a hope actually that you will have gradual return to equilibrium? So with this machinery. So in his Nobel lecture, Prigozhin in 1977 observed that local stability of thermodynamic equilibrium is due to the fact that thermodynamic potentials serve as Lyapunov functions near the equilibrium. You remember this example where Hamiltonian was minus Cz, right? So it was contracting to the equilibrium, and Z is kind of free energy in this story, right? Or minus free energy. So that's exactly what Prigozhin had in mind in our language, and he addressed the question, does stability property hold further away from the equilibrium? So now there is a group of authors. Let me mention some of them. So Bravetti, Gotto, Grumiala, De Leon, Mashkin, Rugala, Wanderschaft. So they proposed description of relaxation processes in terms of asymptotic trajectories of contact Hamiltonian systems. So kind of slow, so in my understanding, it's just very slow processes which preserve germs of Legendrians. And it should be understood the following way, the following thing, that the fact, I mean, this contact form, dz minus pdq, I mean, this Gibbs form, is zero on equilibrium Legendrians. That's basically the first law of thermodynamics. Yeah, so dz is increment the energy, and it's given pdq. And so thus, in principle, it makes sense to think about thermodynamical processes as processes preserving germs of Legendrian, so kind of contact dynamics. And of course, I mean, we will not give to reality opportunity to mislead ourselves. Yeah, so kind of. So then, I mean, we jumped with Misha Entov on this proposal. So let's try to detect stability of these relaxation processes by using existence of asymptotic trajectories coming from contact topology. So our logic was like this, that exactly as symplectic topology, contact topology enables one to do something robust, yeah? So something which is robust to C0 perturbations. So then, if indeed kind of we agree that asymptotic courts of Hamiltonian systems describe relaxation processes, so then symplectic machinery can enter the play, okay? And merit, as I said, is this robustness to mild perturbations, well away from the Legendrian. And the main question of the talk is the following. So does contact dynamics actually adequately describe relaxation processes? So whether there is any hope or any meaning in what kind of in this approach. Okay, so I would say that more I am working quite a number of years on this project, and more I'm working, kind of less I'm sure that the answer is unambiguously yes. But I think that there are some interesting facets of these questions, which I will show you now. Okay, and so now we come to an example. So its case study is Curie-Weiss magnet. It's mean field easing model, and so let me describe it carefully. So we consider complete graph with n vertices, and our configuration space is usually is functions on this graph to minus 1, 1. So the total, so just think like this. So you have your kind of system, and in each vertex you have a spin, right? So then you can consider total spin, so it's just sum of this plus ones and minus ones. And as a Hamiltonian, we write the following expression, minus q times m, so m is total spin, minus bm square over 2n, and q is external magnetic field and b interaction parameter. So in my story, b will be bigger than zero. It's represent ferromagnetic material where spins tend to align, okay? And general pressure is just dh. I mean, if you calculate, it's like average spin, something which is called magnetization. So now here is the story, right? So you have a graph, right? So you have a graph, you have spins up and down, and you can include magnetic field in the direction, this up, down, right? So the system is, in a sense, pretty stupid. So if your magnetic field is kind of strong and looks up, so spins tend to go up. And if it's strong and looks down, points down, so then they tend to point down. So of course, I mean, if there is no magnetic field, so then there is no preference between up and down. And I mean, you also have a mixed kind of mixed state as a possibility. So this specific form of the Hamiltonian, so is again kind of pretty standard. So now, okay. So now comes something which must be said, because otherwise it will be nonsense. And this is already some trouble on the equilibrium level. And the trouble is as follows. So we don't want to do finite easing chain, okay? So we have, roughly speaking, two possibilities. So to do finite easing chain with n huge, or just to go to the limit, okay? And so that's what we will have in mind. So n goes to the limit is called thermodynamic limits. And what we will do, we normalize this m. So remember that m was just sum of the spins, right? So sum of n pluses and minuses. So we normalize, we divide this by n, we get something in the interval minus 1, 1, which is kind of pretty dense, I should say. And the approach is to push forward everything to this segment, okay? So actually, kind of our manifold X in this story will be segment minus 1, 1. Okay, so sometimes we will think about it as R, so it will be even kind of closed segment. We will throw away the endpoints. And you get the following effective Hamiltonian, which depends on P, so on this magnetization, and Q, on the magnetic field, which has, under certain assumption of the parameters, which is interesting assumption, so B beta bigger than zero, bigger than one, it has the following form. So this form is important. So it has two minima and one maxima. Yeah. So this is kind of two stable equilibrium, and this is unstable equilibrium. And this minimum is small, is more minimum. I mean, not all minimums are equal. Yeah. And so this minimal is smaller than this minimal. So this minimal is called metastable, and this is stable. So metastable is a catchy word which will play an important role in my talk. Okay? So let's describe equilibrium Legendrian. So we have our thermodynamic phase space. R of ZPQ with the form dz minus PdQ, z is free energy, Q exterior magnetic field, and P this magnetization, which is properly normalized average spin. So then equilibrium Legendrian has the following form. So this is a Lagrangian projection to PQ plane, and this is the front. Yeah, so it has two cusps and one double point. I mean, and it's given by explicit formula. So what is good, I mean, I'm not telling you, but in textbooks you can find absolute description of this submanifold for the Curie-Weiss model. Okay, so of course, I mean, this structure is important. Yeah. So now for fixed n, denoted by lambda n, Legendrian associated to Curie-Weiss, as in this general recipe, which I described to you at the very beginning, with this free energy and generating function, and so on. But then, in order to pass to thermodynamic limit, we will do the following. So we have, so you see, we're doing a pretty dramatic kind of shift of attention. So our state space at the beginning was huge. It was the space of function on the complete graph, okay? But we don't want it. We want to push everything via this average spin to interval minus one, one. So it's not my idea, it's idea, okay, I will tell you where it was used kind of a little bit later. So it's a procedure which is called, I don't know, lumping in this story. So denoted by Rn, the forward of the Gibbs distribution. So then we will have a Gibbs distribution for given n on this segment. And the point is that these Gibbs distributions converge to delta measure concentrated at stable equilibrium. So geometrically, we get the following thing. So this is my Lagrangian, my Legendrian. So this is Lagrangian projection, and this is front projection. So lambda n correspond to this kind of red things. And we will concentrate on stable part of our Legendrian submanifold. So metastable, which is in blue, is ignored. Unstable is also ignored. Okay, and I would say that maybe, I mean, this Legendrian, I kind of realized this pretty recently when I was essentially preparing the talk, that it could be that this Legendrian gives some link between kind of my story and actually C0 contact topology, because it's obviously kind of not smooth Legendrian, right? What I described here. So it could be of importance. So in principle, it might be that some logical step would be to extend our theory with nth to such Legendrians, which we have no clue how to do. But anyway, so this is in a sense kind of packaging of what again you can find in the textbooks. Okay, so now. Up to here, we are in the stable world, yeah, in the equilibrium world. So now comes non-equilibrium world. So we want to consider the following situation. We have our Markov chain. So Markov chain is in equilibrium. So we perturbed it, and then switched on some process, which returns it to the equilibrium. And one such process, a very famous one, was invented by another Nobel Prize winner, Glauber, in 1963, so 60 years ago, right? And he suggested a Markov chain on this space of states. Okay, and so again, it depends on n transition probabilities. It converges to stable equilibrium, so I will omit, of course, details. And it has a very amusing effect, which I'm not sure I witnessed it in contact dynamics before. Okay, it's called metastability. So as I said, The system, I mean, it's Markov chain, ergodic chain, it converges to stable equilibrium, and you remember that Gibbs kind of equilibrium corresponds in the thermodynamic limit to the stable equilibrium, to this stable equilibrium, to global minimum. So somehow unstable and metastable critical points are completely forgotten in this picture. But actually, it turns out that metastable are not forgotten, because metastability is the following effect. So if we start somewhere in the neighborhood of metastable equilibrium, so then we kind of spend near this equilibrium huge amount of time. Yeah, so for finite by large n, we spend exponentially large time in n near this stable equilibrium, and only then kind of converge to the stable one, okay? So somehow the system remembers in some way this metastability. And this is, yes?
You see the height of the wave, the number C.
I cannot answer this question, but it's absolutely should be related to this height of the well, to the work which kind of you done, and I still cannot explain how. Okay, so it's yeah, and I will not because I cannot pronounce words in the correct order. Yeah, so okay, so I would say that this metastability is one of the most amusing for me phenomena which I wish to go towards it. Yeah. Okay, and so in the limiting dynamics, however, so if n actually goes to infinity, so then you get what is called Glauber-Rudy, it's p dot equals to minus p plus hyperbolic tangens beta times q plus bp. Q is parameter, so it's kind of differential equation in one variable, you can kind of solve it, yeah? So, you see just two stable, one unstable equilibrium, so this metastability is completely lost. So somehow in this story, it's important to work with not really in the limit, but kind of for n huge, okay? Any questions? Okay, so here is illustrating picture number one. So if you consider this curve and you look at this line, so you just see two stable and one unstable equilibrium for the Glauber dynamics, okay? And metastable behavior is strange kind of, right? So your Markov chain first goes to metastable and so then goes to stable. So makes a kind of, you know, like in this Melancholia movie, it's makes some strange trick and goes to the stable part. Okay, and Oscar Penrose and Leibovitz characterized metastable thermodynamic states as follows. So a system that starts in this state is likely to take a long time to get out, and when once it's gotten out, it's unlikely to return. So that's more or less how we can remember this. And there is a slightly different context, the kind of textbook example of metastability, so super cold water, right? So if you, you can find sometime in your fridge water kind of, which is still liquid, but beyond the freezing point, but then if you perturb it kind of abruptly, so it will become an ice immediately. So that's kind of the phenomenon which we can observe in real life. Okay, so now the point is the following. Very good, so we were very happy that there is at least something concrete in this story, so there is this Glauber dynamics. And so then let's model it by contact flow, okay, and apply, later on this perturbation. But unfortunately, life is more complicated than that, okay? So. You see, in our story, magnetic field is constant. So we cannot model Glauber dynamics by constant magnetic field. So what we can do, we can model it if effective magnetic field Q plus BP is constant, okay? And so then, I mean, you can try to get a kind of actual model and describe perturbations and so on, okay? So this was the subject of our paper, which now appeared after all in nonlinearity, but somehow if you want to be stubborn and stand on Q equal constant, so then you can prove an Augur theorem, which roughly states that simply Glauber ODE cannot be included in a natural way into the contact dynamics, okay? And so then you have to compromise. So I mean, global thing doesn't exist, so let's compromise. So it's possible locally. Goto found it in a neighborhood of the double point, kind of in a punctured neighborhood of a double point. And we with Goto and Schei-Lehrer found Hamiltonian in a neighborhood of cusp, which kind of little calculation which requires some singularities theory, okay? But here is a different idea. So, this is the idea which I wish to kind of sell. So the idea to use some, to build some kind of global Hamiltonian which does almost what we want. So we return to generating functions, description, and so let's consider kind of situation we are used to, right? So we have a generating function, we have, let's see, we have Legendrian generating function quadratic at infinity, and Xi is a ghost variable. And starting from now, my attention will be actually on this ghost variable. So ghost variables start playing a major role in what's going on, okay? So I wish to fix a Riemannian metric on this Xi space and look at the gradient equation, okay? Xi dot equals minus delta, minus nabla phi, Q fixed with respect to Xi. And so assume that our function is like this, that we really kind of converge to minimum, okay? I mean, there are, in principle, there could be examples. But at least for some initial conditions, right? So then my suggestion was, our suggestion was to look at the contact Hamiltonian, which actually does not depend on P, so it's very simple Hamiltonian. It's of the form minus Z plus phi Q, Xi QT, right? And then you can write down Hamiltonian system, which does almost what we want, but there is a kind of extra term, which roughly speaking corresponds to equation of variations, to dependence on of this gradient system on initial condition. Yes.
Your function is convex at infinity, more than quadratic. It looks like you converge to minimum moving fiber lines.
Yes. So, but again, so what was the
comment? So it looks like your generating function is convex at infinity, more than quadratic.
You mean original with entropy or something?
No, this is phi.
Yes, but this is just, it's abstract phi. It's, I did not say anything about it, okay? I'm just discussing some abstract and not super profound kind of remark that if you have a generating function and consider gradient flow with respect to ghost variables, so I can get some control system which brings me at least to certain parts of the Legendrian submanifold with, okay, with some kind of help of the gods, right? Because, I mean, certain term should converge to zero. Okay, and the conjecture is that in interesting situation, I mean, you can indeed prove this, and there is one case for very special choice of phi. Okay, actually, when ghost variable has dimension one, when we checked all the details, it's a calculus, long calculus exercise, but you can indeed do this, which would, I think, geometrically correspond to some smoothing of the Goto picture near the double point. Okay, but it's already time dependent, so kind of autonomous. Yeah? But of course, you are right, Marco, that I want to apply now this thing to the original generating function. Okay, and so, and here I enter to the following story. So, what is the meaning of gradient equation when xi actually equals to rho? So, when this is a probability density. So, for our original generating function. And so then the answer is quite nice. So remember that free energy is kind of entropy term and average energy term. And consider, okay, so then the question arises, I mean, which metric to choose? But I think that on the space of measures, yeah, so if you will be asked in the middle of the night which metric you want to choose, you will say Wasserstein metric, right? So because it's just on that. Yeah, and so you choose Wasserstein metric, and that's idea, I think, due to Otto, at least, yeah, so physicist. Yeah, and there is a very nice paper by John Lott, who kind of explains for stupid people how kind of one does calculations with this metric. And it is, by the way, defined in the following way. So if you have a tangent vector rho dot to the tangent to the space of measures, so you have unique, well, let's pretend that M is a closed manifold, exactly as my segment, open segment minus one, one. Yeah, so it was a joke. So in the closed manifold, you take unique function with zero mean, and you identify rho dot with psi, which is roughly some kind of Laplace equation, yeah? And then you define metric as product of gradients of these functions, okay? And on open manifolds, you probably should, I mean, we discussed this with Leonie Ryzhik, so one should use some asymptotic boundary conditions, but technically this could be more complicated. And so then, fantastic news. So gradient flow is something which is called Fokker-Planck equation. So d rho dt equals to beta inverse Laplacian rho plus Nabla rho Nabla h. H is given. And this is equation which consists of two terms. So this is diffusion and this is drift. Okay, so that's elementary calculation appearing in papers, yeah? And I wish to, and actually it is used by physicists to describe some relaxation processes in thermodynamics. And I think that interesting point is the following, right? So we started, so note that logic was actually pretty, how to say it, softly indirect, right? So we started with a Markov chain, which is kind of manifestly some kind of diffusion, right? So then we wrote ODE for some kind of integrated parameters, yeah? So then we tried to massage this ODE to make it contact or whatever. So then we found some way to do it via generating functions, right? But note that all kind of chances to get diffusion apparently disappeared, yeah? So we're doing deterministic dynamics. But if we're kind of doing this in the language of measures, so then this diffusion pops itself again, okay? So we get this Fokker-Planck. Okay, and so starting from this point, the only thing which I can tell you, so it's science fiction. So science fiction is what I want to do. I want to get reincarnation of metastability. So conjecture is the following, that this Fokker-Planck for huge n, but finite n, actually recovers this metastable behavior. And a potential strategy is the following. So we wish to compare, this Fokker-Planck with an auxiliary system. We keep 1 over n, so kind of small parameter at diffusion term, and leave drift, I mean, for the drift, we pass to the limit. Okay, so why this is kind of justified? So this is the problem. This is the whole story. But now, again, kind of, you can calculate that this drift term in certain coordinates is equivalent in some way to the Glauber ODE, okay? And, there is some nuance here, so I did not tell how to define correctly Riemannian metric on the segment, because metric on, I mean, this Wasserstein metric depends on the Riemannian structure, right? But anyway, the main kind of promise is the following, that people were considered for such kind of PDEs, so diffusion and small drift, small diffusion plus drift, so they actually studied metastability. So there were work by Fredlin, Wenzel, Fredlin, Karalov, and the work which I looked at, Ishii, Suganidis, so they actually kind of, they forget Markov chain, so they work about metastability for parabolic PDEs, okay? So somehow, if one can do kind of this move, so then the strategy in principle might work, and then one can formulate the next conjecture that metastability actually will hold for the contact Hamiltonian associated to this gradient flow, okay? So what I'm suggesting to do, so I'm suggesting to write Fokker-Planck, so use it as a control for contact Hamiltonian, and so then if we can prove that Fokker-Planck inherits metastability, so then this contact Hamiltonian also inherits some metastable behavior. Okay, so now comes epilogue, okay? So it's interlinking in Curie-Weiss model. So assume that our parameters be beta, so remember that we had this Curie-Weiss model, right? So I think already kind of about thermodynamic limit, if you wish, okay? So B was interaction beta inverse temperature. And so now assume that these parameters change to A bigger than B and alpha bigger than beta. I must, right, so that's kind of the most interesting case which we can treat. We can choose the coordinate system, convenient kind of coordinate system, where lambda B beta, so kind of original Legendrian submanifold is a zero section simply, and the new one looks like this, or like this, right? Depending on new kind of, so phase transition here happens when alpha times A minus B bigger than one, alpha times A minus B less than one, and you see that you have unique chord kind of joining this Legendrian submanifold. So asking your question, yeah, so this is the example when you have unique chord. Yes.
But in general, for chords and cotangent bundles, there should be like dimension of homology of the base many chords, right?
No, it could be simply no chords, right? So we're looking at chords from one to another. Put one above another, so there will be no chords going in this direction. It's rep chord, okay? And so the answer kind of depends. Yeah, so it's oriented story, right? So we go from one submanifold to another submanifold. And this is an example where we have interlinking. So you can ask a different question. So how we kind of, we proved some theorem for closed base and use it for open base, but I mean, there are some tricks allowing to do this. And thus the grand goal is the following. So we want not only to design contact Hamiltonian modeling relaxation by using all this scheme which I described, right? So via Fokker-Planck and this construction with a kind of control, and but then detect by our tools with ENTOF robustness of asymptotic trajectories via interlinking. And that's the end of my talk.
Thank you very much. Any question?
In this last slide, when you have a unique chord, do you see it as a limit of some discrete something as entering to infinity?
No, not yet. So we even no. We didn't work on this. So this story about thermodynamic limit is appeared when I tried to prepare the talk. We kind of always put it under the carpet. Yeah.
Yes, thank you, Lorena, for this inspiring talk. There's one thing I didn't quite understand, because stability should be that wherever you start from, you end up on your Legendre manifold. And here what you seem to say is that you can find the trajectory that ends up starting from another Legendre, but you can find one trajectory which doesn't look like stability.
No, that's...
On the other hand, it seems that you have the choice of the Hamiltonian, which is not the case. Usually, stability, you're given Hamiltonian, you have to give that. So is there a kind of trade-off between one?
I think this is philosophical question what you're asking, because the question is, what is equilibrium thermodynamical system, and it's a Legendrian submanifold, so it's not one point in the state space, and my view at non-equilibrium thermodynamics is like this, that along your equilibrium Legendrian, you can kind of move freely, yeah, so you can always arrange. But the question is, for me, relaxation is just one asymptotic trajectory joining pair of Legendrian submanifolds. Okay, I don't pretend, and I probably have no chance to prove that everything will be stable. I don't expect this, but we expect the following thing, that at least, I mean, there is one way, or maybe finite number of ways, to pass from one, from perturb equilibrium system to given equilibrium system. So that's why in this situation, right? So how I describe perturbation? I did not say that I was in a certain point in the phase space, and now I'm in a different. I said that let's change parameters of the system. So be beta move to A alpha. And this means that I'm drawing immediately kind of another easing model with these parameters. Okay, and so my Lagrangian, my Legendrian submanifold appears naturally in this situation. Okay, and so then I say that relaxation is just one trajectory.
More questions?
First, maybe a basic one. In the second part of your talk, the Legendre was arbitrary. I mean, the contact manifold was an arbitrary dimension. You're just drawing it in three dimensions.
Mm-hmm.
So this idea of having a relaxed Legendre, say I take an arbitrary Legendre, but it has a generating family, and I apply your relaxation convergence method, you have a way of picking out another Legendrian for all sorts of front singularities. I mean, you were just drawing it for crossings and cut, you know, simple.
I think, look, yes, I understand what you're asking. Yes. So here we used normal form for semi-cubical parabola. Okay, so in order to prove this, that you get kind of relaxing Hamiltonian. Yeah, so we actually used some singularity theory on a very basic level, kind of. Yeah, so you first course some singularity theory, but it still was some singularity theory. So if singularity is complicated, so then I'm afraid it's sometimes even impossible, because I wanted to generalize this story to swallow tail, and you already should be accurate. So somehow, and now what I mean accurate, because physics gives you labelings on these branches, which is stable, which is metastable, and so on, right? And if you really want to preserve this, it could be impossible. Okay, so. Yes or no, even if singularity is sufficiently complicated, it could be locally impossible. So that's what I think. Okay. But then maybe you can kind of apply kind of next method, which here was sold as a global method, to analysis of singularity. But that's even cannot imagine how to do.
Those are many questions, but I don't understand the physics well. But this is stability, metastability, and stability. Is there some relation to the kind of some spectral properties of the like the graph selector?
Yes. So, and I think that in the yes. So it's related. So let me show you a picture, and it was yes. So I think Lim and Youngen. They looked at a different example. So I think you did liquids, right? So yes, and so they mentioned that this stable thing corresponds exactly to the point where graph selector is achieved. Okay, so I don't know how this can be used. Okay, but it's certainly kind of an observation which appears in their article, and I think that in some way it's also kind of between the lines in the article of Goto, yeah, so considered kind of a double point, yeah. And yes.
Can I make a comment about this construction?
Yes.
This construction was due to Maxwell. This is one of the very important construction thermodynamics. So for Maxwell's construction. So what he noticed is that this is related to the phase differential what Leonid talked about in the Bartolov example. So I think that phase transition is something related to a certain problem of certain feeding in the short time. So this is very famous actually.
Yes, yes, so I told this that it's called Maxwell phenomenon, right? But of course Maxwell did not know what is graph selector, so.
but anyway, so then it's easier robust in some ways.
Yes. So actually, again, I believe that when so what is missing? I think I convinced you. That the precise model of relaxation is missing. Okay. So what I presented was kind of suggestion with some dances around, yeah, which were. It turns out that it's related to something which indeed physicists used to this Fokker-Planck. I believe at the moment we will have some kind of system of laws, yeah, so how this non-equilibrium thermodynamics can be written in contact world, yeah, so then all these tools, of course, and selectors and persistence, and yeah, so as Claude hinted, yeah, so I mean. So it was the secret bar in the story, right? So we'll enter the place, the play, and we'll get some theory.
Okay, so I suggest we thank Leonid again.